He works.
Just been past the microphone. Is it on? Can you hear
me?
No.
David is from Cambridge University Library, and together we're working on a project called DPOC, which is Digital Preservation at Oxford and Cambridge.
So the DPOC project is a 2-year project, so we've got to work out how to preserve everything in 2 years. And then preserve it all. No, we don't. We're just really doing some initial research to try and get preservation practice more ingrained in both of our libraries. We better put a word in for the funder, Luxembourg Foundation. Over the years, they've funded literally millions of pounds worth of digitisation of the stuff that we have in our libraries. And we finally managed to convince them that they should really put some money towards making sure that it's still available in 50 or 100 years' time. So.
So why are we here today? We've had the opportunity to talk to you all about preservation. And so far, people have mentioned it in the 2 days that we've been here, which has been really encouraging, that people are thinking about it, but maybe don't have the answers. We certainly don't have all the answers, but by you being all here, it's showing us that you are the evangelists for this, and we want to tap into you to hopefully help promote some preservation actions into your projects or projects that you work on. As Diego said at the beginning of day one, researchers are often wanting to publish or perish, so there's this fear of taking time to do preservation on your research, and people don't necessarily understand the value of it. And Josh also mentioned that when he was talking to the researchers, there was a lack of motivation about why should I care. I don't care who's going to look at my research after I've finished with it. I just want to get it done and move on to the next project. Maybe pay off my mortgage, something like that. And we don't have the answer to how to motivate researchers to start thinking about preservation, but if you are involved in that, then hopefully we can promote some preservation elements into their workflows to help with future researchers when they do come to look back on their research and their data.
So yes, so we're here really just to pose a whole load of questions for which we don't have any answers. As James says, hopefully we'll get you thinking about them. Some of the objects that we have to start thinking about how we preserve are kind of listed at the bottom of this slide. So, data environments, the workflows, publications, and then other things that we haven't really talked much about today, such as the email that we may have sent as part of the project. We'll talk a bit more about that later on. We'll have a slide about that in a minute.
So, are you thinking about the future? Whilst your project is funded, everything's fine, you've got the infrastructure, everything's going well. Previous speaker was talking about having steps to ensure that their research was reproducible, they were doing continuous testing, making sure their images were all good, and that other researchers within that institution could continue to reproduce their research. So if the research is being reused by your peers now, that's probably not a problem because you've got the funding, you've still got the infrastructure to support it. But going forward, once your project's finished, and there's no more funding, and you start wrapping up things, and the infrastructure gets closed down, and there's no money to carry on supporting it, but you're starting to think about, well, I need to deposit this somewhere else. What are you going to deposit, and how easy is it going to be for someone in 5, 10, 50 years' time to look back at that and actually make any sense of it at all? What is the shelf life of that research output? It's all well and good saying we've got cloud resources in the future. We don't know what the landscape is, and as part of our role, we are looking much more into the future rather than what's happening now. but it's interesting, we've started to see people using Docker containers and other types of containers, and it sort of piqued our interest to start looking at this and thinking, how are we going to preserve these? Because they've already started to make some, we've started to see some challenges already, and it's been really interesting to hear different approaches that people have taken throughout their own research projects. And so just having a thought of, does your environment actually have a best before date? Is there a figure in mind that you're working to say, well, I only need this research for the next 2 years, and after that, well, I don't care, because I'm on the next project, and someone else can worry about what I've left behind.
Okay, so one question that we had to ask is about how you might actually store everything. So the question really is it better to store all the components of your research as individual pieces or wrap them all up in one container? And there's probably, it depends answer to that question, I would say. Could you just move on a slide? Because I think one of the areas where you might want to think about maybe splitting stuff off is actually at the data level. And I think, you know, we've already had a kind of discussion about how that might be a better practice than wrapping all your data up in the container as well. So one of the pieces of kit that we've reviewed as part of our work over the last couple of months is a thing called the Database Preservation Toolkit. That comes from a project called EARC. I recommend everybody look at EARC because it's a very interesting project. They took the kind of standard model of digital preservation from about 2003, I think the first proposal for the digital preservation repository was standardised. And then they thought, right, how can we fling all the modern cloud tools at it and decouple it all so that it could be scaled up to the sort of scales that you folks out there, you people out there work at. So as part of that project, they've developed a tool called the Database Preservation Toolkit, as I say, and that's for standardising database systems. So if you've got, I think it's basically compatible with the four that everybody uses, and you can take your database and either standardise the whole thing or a subset of it in a preservable format, which can then be either used natively or re-imported into any of the others. So that's the sort of kind of approach that preservation people like. So it's kind of taking non-standard, maybe proprietary formats and making them more standard and open. Okay, so this is where we talk a little bit more about some of the other stuff as well. There's a word that archivists love, and I don't know what it means, but it's basically a provenance, so the idea of the kind of history of how things came about. They also love the idea of context as well. So this is the part which I think might be quite controversial with everyone, because this is about actually thinking about how do we preserve stuff that wasn't core to the research, potentially, at the end. And one obvious one of those is email. The research director manager in my office just wandered through one day in a bit of a huff, I don't know why, and basically said, can you tell me what the date is when people stop caring about researchers' data and start caring about all the email that they used to send? Because this is sort of something where I think it happens, you'll know you've really made it as a scientist or as a researcher when people start saying, what was that relationship with the other person that was called to your work like? And do you have any kind of evidence of that discussion going back and forwards? So we choose like really fishing for a date off. We're not so worried so much about the research output now. We want to know about the context, and it's something that archivists are very, very interested in. So just to sort of complicate that, if you move on to the next slide. So this, dog's breakfast behind me, was based on a 2-hour chat that I had with a neurobiological project, I think is the correct phrase for it. I don't know what I'm talking about. Anyway, they basically try and map the neural connections in flies' brains. So I just asked, what software do you use? And this is the picture that came out. And I missed quite a lot from it as well. So I've only really shown, apparently this is one of kind of medium to average complexity rather than one of the really, really complicated ones. And it's really just showing about software dependencies between But what's particularly interesting about this one is, if you look in the middle, they've actually integrated their Slack channel, where they talk to each other, that kind of correspondence stuff, with their raw data. So they'll actually say, they'll start a conversation about who's doing what, and this is between a lab in America and here. Who's doing what now? And they can actually pull the data out of the database into Slack and then start talking about it. So at that point, who knows what's archived, right?
Yeah.
Do you want to
move on? Yep.
Oh, this is me again as well. Okay, so last week we went to a Digital Preservation Coalition presentation, and we started thinking about documenting as well. So when you're thinking about documenting software, you actually start, you're probably thinking at a slightly higher level than maybe people in 20 or 30 years' time are going to need to actually understand what you're actually doing. There's sort of a kind of muscle memory involved in computing sometimes. There are such low-level activities that you just do every day that you don't even realise. But, in 20 or 30 years' time, they're going to confuse people. So, by way of example, who remembers this piece? We're stealing this from last week. Okay, who had one of these? Yeah? Okay. So, would you like to tell me, when you put your 5¼-inch floppy disk in your floppy drive, what key combination did you press to load it? Oh, somebody did it. What? Blimey. You're quite young. How do you know that? My family wasn't rich enough to afford all these. So yeah, Spectrum instead. So I spent the whole weekend trying to remember the same combination of the Spectrum. Can anyone remember that one? Oh, you're richer. That's why. Load quote. And on Monday morning I remembered it. And that, to be honest, was the only thing I ever typed into my Spectrum for about 10 years. But it took me like 5 days to remember. So this is sort of what we mean by documentation. It's not just the, load your Docker container or whatever. For people in 30 years' time, you have to really document everything.
So obviously, there's been a lot of discussion about what containers people are using, and it's already been discussed, strengths and weaknesses of Docker and Singularity. But I made this very quick, simple user story. It's 10 years in the future. Marty McFly is tasked with reproducing research that used Docker. Docker is no more. It doesn't exist anymore. It's stopped. It's gone. For whatever reason, legal, there's a cease and desist. Everyone has to delete anything to do with Docker. Maybe Docker's been superseded by a product called Harpoon, which was then rebranded, but now everyone uses Sting. So no one really remembers Docker. People, he asks in the department, well, how did Docker work? And everyone sort of goes, oh, I remember that stuff. Yeah, it was around, 2015, something like that, it was quite popular. But luckily, our web archiving has captured docker.com, so we've got all the documentation, but it didn't save any of the software, so there's no Docker Hub, there's no obvious repositories, and he's looking for, where do I get this Docker image people keep talking about? How do I install Docker? And then someone says, oh, I found someone actually copied the Docker source code. And then he says, oh great, I'll just go and compile it. I know how that, we can emulate x86 PC. And who here has actually tried to compile Docker from the source without using Docker? Yeah.
That's a good one.
It's just me, because I thought, oh okay, well I'll be the guinea pig. It's slightly concerning when you read the documentation, people advise you to say the best way to compile Docker is using Docker. Is that right? That doesn't seem right to me. And then you just have to think about all the dependencies within an image where you've got this layered file system, which is great, it's flexible and it's efficient, but people seem to forget that they saved off their bit of their Docker image and not necessarily the entire dependencies and all those sorts of things. So is there a better option for archiving and preservation?
I think you might know what's coming now. Yeah.
So is Singularity, does that work for preservation? Is it a better platform? So you've got this single container full of goodness. But how do we know what's inside that? So there's, again, with all of these things, you need to know a lot more information than just the Docker image. So you do need to know, what's the environment? Have you got the source code to install Singularity to run and open this container? And have you got all the other relevant metadata so that you can not just inspect it, but actually open it? Because otherwise, you just don't have a can opener, is how I sort of look at it. So a good example of this is if you think of unplugging your unplug from the network, someone gives you a blank machine, and you go and take the things that's been deposited outside of your organisation and you try and recreate your total environment and can you reproduce research and what stumbling blocks might you come across.
Okay, so in those 10 years' time, what might the big problem be? Time precludes me from going into too much detail, but the only question I've asked here today was on the very first person who spoke, asking them about how badly tightly coupled to NVIDIA the kind of work that some of you were discussing is. How many of you actually use GPUs or any kind of 3D modelling work? Yes. Less than I was expecting, but the two biologists I've spoken to both use it quite heavily. But of course, at this software emulation workshop we were at last week, everyone was talking about licensing of software being a big problem. But for me, licensing of hardware is an even bigger problem in this particular space at the moment. If you go, all the emulation work that they showed got us beautifully up to 16-bit SNES games. But beyond that point, it's really hard because you're then into proprietary 3D graphics acceleration. NVIDIA provided an emulator, I believe, but I would imagine for maybe some example small models would be okay. But for actually trying to recreate the sort of research that I've had explained to me today or over the last 2 days, running that kind of stuff through an emulator, you would need preserving by the end of the time that took to run. So,
So a quick show of hands, who've actually deposited research data in a repository? Okay, who've actually deposited software in a research data repository? Yeah?
Oh, good. Fantastic.
So as part of our project, we reviewed our repositories and we found that we couldn't identify quite a lot of the stuff in it. We didn't know what the content was, so 52% in Oxford's, 44% in Cambridge's. The tool we use for this is some people might be interested. We use Droid, which is provided by National Archives. It scans the header, looks at the byte order, uses Pronom, which is a technical registry for file formats, and tries to work out what the file format is and the versions. So one of the things we wanted to quickly mention was let's try and make it better by getting people who do deposit research data to let us know what that data is and provide us with file signatures so we can identify it. Again, if you have any questions about this, please do contact us. By doing this, it makes your data more accessible. So in summary, think about preservation.
And there's a few things on this slide. We're pretty aware that the kickback that we'll always get, because our research management teams get it in both our universities, the kickback is obviously, I have to publish, I have to get my research done, I have no time to think about preservation. So I'm going to end on a really macabre note, actually, to do with this word in the middle, which is legacy. I get the idea that as scientists, you sort of are in the kind of now and the future all the time, and you're kind of encouraged to have a heads up and look at the new stuff that's coming along. And in academia, I think universities, the more, if you're a successful scientist, which I think you all will be, you become a professor, and then you become an emeritus professor, and they never shut your office, and they never switch your email off, and you're always encouraged constantly to look out at the future. And I think that's quite often to the detriment of your legacy, of the work that you've actually done. I don't know this for sure, I'm only getting this second hand, but one of my colleagues on our half of the project has worked very closely with archivists, actually taking donations from professors or from the family of deceased professors quite often. And she's been in situations where people have, you know, recently had a very uncomfortable conversation with their doctor. And it's only at that point where they're starting to think, what's my legacy? What am I actually going to give over that actually sets that record of my work? So yeah, so I always finish with a song.